إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Today we're going to be continuing our discussion on Surah Al-Fatiha. Does anyone have a handout that I gave? You got one? Okay. So basically, I just want to briefly recap what we covered previously. Surah Al-Fatiha, basically in the order of the Qur'an, if you open the Qur'an today, it's the first chapter that is there in the Qur'an. And it's what we have to, what we are required to read in every salah, in every prayer, in every unit of prayer, which we call a raka'ah. A Muslim is required to recite that. And we had discussed that Surah Al-Fatiha is the journey of a pure soul. And what I mean by that is all of us were born with an innate nature of goodness. And every soul received this innate nature of goodness from the time from which before we entered this world. What do I mean by that? Before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent all of us down on earth, He took us, after He created Adam alayhi salam, He took all of the creation. Before I continue, make sure everyone gets a handout for today. I think three people. Don't mind passing them over to them. So basically, He took all of humanity out. Jazakallah khair. He took all of humanity out from basically Adam alayhi salam. All of our souls came out, and all of humanity was there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us testify that He is our Lord and He is our Master. And this incident is in the Quran, and or it's in the Hadith, and it's alluded to in the Quran as well. And after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us to earth. We don't have an exact memory of that incident. You know, obviously, I don't think anyone remembers, you know, meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and saying this. But we kind of have a memory in our heart, which is that feeling that there is a God, that we should serve and worship that one God, and also that innate nature of goodness also gives us a moral compass in a sense. We know that things such as killing, stealing, you know, there are certain crimes all humans, they know, whether they were taught a religion or not. They just naturally know these things are bad, and things like helping people and being nice to people are things that are good. This is all a result of that meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before we came onto earth. And that's why when you meet people, whether they're Muslim or they're not Muslim, you know, many people will, they have some sentiment to believe in God. And even those who say they don't believe in God, if they are put in a very pressured situation, such as there's a lot of turbulence on the plane and the pilot's like, we're gonna have a rough landing, we don't know if we're gonna land in one piece, you will see a lot of people, you know, in their heart even, they might pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they might pray to God. Then once they land, they might forget about it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about that also in the Quran, how the Arab merchants at that time, when they're on their ships and there's a lot of tidal waves and they're not sure if they're gonna make it back to land, they stop worshiping their idols, they just focus on Allah. But then once they get back to land, it's like that incident never happened. So Surah Al-Fatiha is the journey of that soul. Well, then you might ask, well, if this meeting happened, why isn't the entire world Muslim? Why isn't the whole world worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And why are there people that are doing bad things? The answer to that is, once we arrive on this planet and we arrive on earth and we arrive in this world, our environment affects that state of the soul. If you put something pure and you leave it in a room with a lot of you know, toxicants and things that could damage it, that item will get corroded. You know, if you it happens to paintings, it happens to sculptures, it happens to so many things that are of value, that, you know, they put them in airtight containers and things like this to preserve them. Just like that, the soul, when it enters this world, depending on the family it grows up in, depending on the society it grows up in, and depending on the experiences and the reaction of that soul to experiences in life, that nature changes. And that person might lose that decency, that innate nature of goodness, or it might decrease. And a very practical example of that, of someone with a really good, and we call this innate nature of goodness in Arabic, we call it the fitrah. The innate nature of goodness, we call it the fitrah in Arabic. And an example of someone with a really good fitrah is Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He was the friend of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before Islam. Once Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him that, you know, I'm a prophet and I have this message, Abu Bakr believed. He didn't even hesitate. He didn't flinch. Then we have another example of Umar radiallahu anhu. He, you know, after Abu Bakr, Umar radiallahu anhu is right there. But he didn't accept Islam right away. In fact, there was a time he was trying to even kill Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when he accepted Islam, he was actually on his way to kill him. And so, it's not to belittle any of the companions or anything of that nature, but it's just to show that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and his ranking is as-Siddiq. It's the ranking right after a prophet. And it's the highest ranking you can get if you're not able to be a prophet. And the reason for that is that his innate nature was kept intact, and he was on that spiritual journey as well before the advent of Islam, just like Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Surah Al-Fatiha has that journey, because when a soul looks around, they will see, you know, the uniqueness of the creation of this world, how everything is in harmony. There's enough oxygen to support life. The sun rises from the east, sets in the west. There's day and night. There's just so many factors in place that are more than just a mere coincidence. And when they realize this, they say Alhamdulillah, and they say that there's all praise to Allah. And then they realize that the being that created all of this is my master, and I should be serving him. And so they say Rabbul Alameen. And then they also realize that they haven't been serving him all this time. Yet Allah didn't punish them. He didn't destroy them. He didn't let them die and face Day of Judgment without having worshipped him. So they realized that this master was like no other master. So they say he is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. He is the extremely merciful and the eternally merciful. And as we discussed before, what's the difference? The difference is that extremely merciful, it's something that's happening right now, but it may not always happen. So what does that mean? It means that in this life, in this world, people who are exposed to the message of the truth, they are exposed to this message, yet they do not accept this message. And only Allah knows who this is. For example, you could talk to someone about Islam, but they may not have understood it. You may have not explained it well. They may have had a previous encounter. They may have been tired. There's an excuse. Only Allah knows, right, really what goes on in our minds and our hearts. So you can't say when you pass out a pamphlet on Islam and the person doesn't accept Islam that, okay, you've done your job, and that person, he's going to hell. No, it doesn't work that way. Look at Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He preached in Mecca for 10 years and he still didn't write them off. But a person who does receive the message and they didn't have an excuse, they understood it, there's no excuse. And only Allah knows who this person is and who fits in this category. Then when they meet Allah on Day of Judgment, they will be treated with justice. But that extra bit of mercy that Allah will give to the believers, that won't be there. And so that extreme mercy is not quite there. Allah is always merciful, and He'll be merciful to the believers in the hereafter. He won't hold us all account for every single thing we did. Inshallah, He'll have mercy on us. But for the disbeliever who received the message and has no excuse, then that mercy is not there. And so those were basically the first two verses that we talked about last week. And then that leads us to today's verse, which is Maliki Yawmiddin. As we had stated last week, and as I just stated, you know, that mercy will not always be there for certain categories of people. People who received the message and they didn't act upon it. Also, even for believers, Allah will have mercy, even though we have shortcomings. We know that some believers will spend time in the hellfire before they enter heaven. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't leave them in hellfire forever for their crimes. That's also a sense of mercy, because He could leave them there forever, because we know that we shouldn't do certain things. Also, Allah will forgive some people who didn't even ask for forgiveness on Day of Judgment. Say a person was addicted to alcohol his whole life, and maybe he made repentance throughout his life, but towards the end of his life, he relapsed again. And he died before he could ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. And then, what ends up happening, he shows up on Day of Judgment. Let's say you even knew this person in this life, and you go to his janazah, and you might be thinking, man, he died an alcoholic, Allah's not going to forgive him. You can't say that. In Islam, we have to believe that a person who commits a major sin, or any sin for example, is subject to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's judgment on Day of Judgment. Allah can forgive that person, and he may not. And I'm talking about cases where the person didn't ask for forgiveness. Bear in mind, this is cases where the person, they died and they never asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness for that sin. When someone asks for forgiveness in this life and they do their best, then inshallah they will be forgiven. But it also answers the question that people say, you know, in Islam, one of the quote-unquote criticisms against it is that there is no God of mercy in Islam. There is no God of love. This is actually quite contrary. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has many names. One of his names is Al-Wadud. It means the most loving. Also, we have Ar-Rahman, extremely merciful. Ar-Rahim, eternally merciful. So the statement that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not merciful or he's a wrathful God, a'udhu billah from saying this, is not true. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very merciful. In fact, in Islam, we believe that it is written above Allah's throne that his mercy has overcome his anger. But that leads us to the question, does that mean a person can do exactly whatever they want in this world and there are no consequences? No. That's why we have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the genius of putting Malik Yawmiddin, because it reminds us that this is the day where you basically reap what you sow. A deen has, actually first of all, Malik, there's two ways you can read it, and they both are accepted. The Arabs had different dialects, basically, when the Quran was sent down, and the Quran actually came in all of these dialects, and it's actually a very lengthy topic, but just to sum it up, when the Quran was written, whatever could be accommodated in the copy that was with Uthman radiallahu anh, those portions of those dialects were preserved. They don't contradict each other. They give different subtleties to the meaning that actually complement and enhance the meaning. And we'll see that right now. First of all, you can read the word as saying, Maliki Yawmiddin. Most of us, we read it as Maliki Yawmiddin. That's what we know. But in different styles of recitation, you can recite it as Maliki Yawmiddin. What's the difference? Malik means king. Malik means owner. You might say, well, that's kind of the same thing. But there actually are some subtleties of difference. Malik is more like a sovereign, someone who has like power over like the entire land, the entire landscape. But for example, the president of the United States, he's not monitoring what's going on in the county. He's not micromanaging, right? The CEO of any company, it's impossible for them to micromanage every single employee of the company, right? It's more of like a macro view. So a Malik can, if he wants to interfere in a particular incident, he can. But he really doesn't have control over everyday incidences. For example, the president doesn't have control over someone running a red light or not. He can't monitor all those different things. He can't monitor every single American who's going to cheat on their taxes, right? He doesn't have that kind of detailed control. He has like a general type of control. Is that understood? Okay, so that's a Malik, so it's like macro level. Malik is more like micro. He's the owner, but the owner of something usually, like if you're the owner of your car, you're in charge of getting the oil changed, you're in charge of getting it fixed, you're in charge of making sure it's clean, you pay attention to every single detail. If there's a dent on that car, you're gonna, you know, complain and get angry about it. So with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have the combination of both. You have someone who has the sovereign, the grand overview power, and also the very detailed power. So grand control and micro control. So basically it's total control. Why is this important? No human being, no matter how hard they have tried, has never been able to attain this. Whether it's Fir'aun, whether it's someone like a Hitler, you know, whether it's like any dictator around today, they strive for this, right? They want to be head of the country, you know, and they want their government agencies to control their citizens, and they want to know every single thing that's going on. But it's impossible. You cannot. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, on that day, I will have total control. Whether you worship me or not, whether you acknowledge me or not in this world, on that day, there's no choice. You have to acknowledge me on that day. And he will have, and that's also comforting. Why? Because oftentimes, whenever you go for a judgment, you go before a judge, there's always the case, the judge, he might, you know, make a mistake, you know, or if you botch your argument, he might misunderstand what you're trying to say, and you may not receive justice. But it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows everything that happens in this world. He knows what we're thinking, what we're saying, and he knows more about incidences that occur in our life than us. You know, you might have had an incident where you accidentally rubbed someone the wrong way. You didn't see it that way. Allah knows. He knows that you did this, you meant this, but the person interpreted it this way. Even with regards to ourselves, we don't have total knowledge of what happened. So it's actually, it's comforting, but it's also scary in the sense that you can't get away with anything. We all have maybe skeletons in the closet, things that we've done we're not proud of, but they got swept under the rug. You know, no one found out, no harm, no foul. But if we don't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us, on that day we'll be asked about it. And what's also interesting is on that day, it's been described that people will, like when they're meeting Allah and they'll be going to the judgment, they'll be thinking, he didn't ask me about this, he didn't ask me about this, I think I've gotten away with it. And then bam, it'll come up. And sometimes Allah will forgive that person. He'll actually conceal that person from the rest of creation. It'll just be you and him. And he'll say, remember, he'll bring out this, this, and this, and this. But wait, what about this? And you'll have no choice. I deserve hellfire. I deserve the punishment. Allah said, you didn't expose your sins. You didn't brag about your sins. So just like you concealed yourself, you covered yourself in this world, I'll cover you in this and in the hereafter. You're free. I won't take you to task for these sins. But those people, those dictators, those people that were in power, those people who were the upper class of society, they harmed poor people. Those people who did Ponzi schemes that didn't get caught in all these investigations, and they're living it up right now. And the people they stole from are living in poverty, and they might live the rest of their life in luxury. On that day, Allah says, you know, the SEC didn't catch you, the FBI didn't catch you, but I saw you, I caught you. You're not getting away with it on this day. You didn't ask for forgiveness. So that's the day of ultimate justice. Also, what's amazing about this verse is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Yawm al-Din. Yawm is, there's many different words for time and that could be used. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word Yawm, or one of the benefits of using the word Yawm is that human beings can never own time. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala owns that day and all that is in it. And he owns time and all that is in it. No human being can say, and I know this might seem abstract, that I own 3 o'clock. And I own all that's contained, whatever happens in 3 o'clock is mine. No human being can say that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can say that. And that again emphasizes the fact that he is in control of everything. And then the next part is ad-deen. Ad-deen has many connotations to it. It had a different meaning before Islam. Some of the meanings that they would say is dintuhu means I served him. In Arabic, if you use this word deen, it used to meant that I served him, or dintulahu, I became obedient to somebody. Also, it carries the meaning following a way of a people. For example, adana bidinihim, that this person followed the culture of these people, or he became obedient to what they became obedient to. And also, there's a saying in Arabic. It says, Kama tudinu tudan, walau ba'dahin. The way you dealt with people is the way you'll get dealt, even if it takes some time. So basically they're saying you're gonna reap what you sow, even if it takes some time for you to get yours, basically, as we say in English. And it also means giving a loan. And this was probably the most prominent original meaning of the word. You gave someone a loan, and all these sayings meant that, for example, if you loaned someone and they didn't pay you back, then if that person, that deadbeat borrower, ended up giving a loan to someone else, then the person who ended up borrowing from him would probably end up treating him the way he treated the person who originally lent him the money. And you might wonder, okay, so why do we say that this is the day you're going to reap what you sow? And why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use this description for the Day of Judgment? For example, we have many names for the Day of Judgment that are mentioned in the Quran. For example, Yawm al-Jam', Yawm al-Hashr, the Day of the Gathering, Yawm al-Qiyamah, the Day of Standing. So these are different names for the Day of Judgment. But why? What's the benefit of using Yawm al-Din? The benefit of that is that this word, ad-Din, is the most comprehensive word you could use to describe the Day of Judgment. Because in the end, it boils down to judgment. It boils down to justice, actually. The Day of Judgment boils down to justice. Yes, there are people that will receive mercy, specifically the believers, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those believers on Day of Judgment. But it's the day of justice. And even the person who ends up in the worst possible place in the hellfire, justice was done to them. They won't get wrong. They won't get an extra iota of punishment. They may have not received mercy, but that doesn't mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wasn't just. Just like, you know, if the cop pulls you over, he can let you go if you were speeding, or he can give you the ticket. If he gives you the ticket and you were speeding and you have no excuse, you can't say he did injustice to you. You know, he basically threw the book at you. He didn't do anything extra. So similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give justice to people. In addition to that, Yawm al-Din also has the implication of scales. You know, when you're loaning people, or, you know, you're measuring things. You know, I gave you a certain amount of money and I expect you to give me a specific amount of money. And also the word dain in Arabic, there's different words also for giving loans. There's qard and there's dain. Dain also has that there's a specific deadline in which you're supposed to pay the person back. So another benefit of that is that this day has a specific time. And there's and when your turn is supposed to come on Day of Judgment, it's set. And there's no escaping your turn, your number on Day of Judgment, and when you have to answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why and that's another benefit of using Yawm al-Din. Also, when you say that you follow the culture of someone else, you're also kind of saying that you're getting used to something. And Day of Judgment is also about getting used to something. What do I mean by that? If you're told you're going to Jannah, get ready. Get used to living in luxury. Get used to happiness. If you're going to the hellfire and you deserve that, get used to that. And in that case, it's sarcasm, because no one will ever be able to get used to the hellfire. But it's going to say, you didn't acknowledge me. You got the truth. You may have even worked against the truth. You may have tried to stop the truth. In the case of people like Pharaoh or Abu Jahl, or people who basically had an agenda against the truth, then okay, get used to this. This is your home now. So it's basic. And because Surah Al-Fatiha is supposed to be a summary of the entire faith, it only makes sense to use the most comprehensive word to describe the Day of Judgment. And also, when we explore this word, we have to again step out of the box and take a look at it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that He is the owner, He is the master of time, of that day, the day, and on that day He will only have control. And He will have control over where you end up. You know, if you're going to be a winner or loser. If He's going to have mercy on you. And that whole entire process. And that people who belittled Him, or who belittled Islam, or the believers on that day, they will receive justice. And there will be moments, for example, on the Day of Judgment, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the believers first see Him, the believers will make ruku', basically this motion. But those people who didn't do that in this life, they won't be able to. So imagine you're standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you won't be able to do it. How tough, how embarrassing is that situation, right? Imagine like you're going to a place and everyone's supposed to be wearing a suit and a tie or supposed to be dressed very elegantly, and you walk in and you're not dressed that way. You know that feeling of embarrassment? You're like, oh, I should have, you know, dressed for the occasion. Imagine this day, you're standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you won't be able to do that. And everyone else is doing it. It's very scary. And that's the day of justice. You know, in this life, nothing really happens to a lot of people that don't do what they're supposed to do. But on that day, if we don't ask for tawbah and we're not a believer, then there's no chance of mercy. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is re-emphasizing. And it also prevents us from taking advantage of His mercy. There are many people that say, oh, Allah is merciful, I can do whatever I want. So right then and there, He's saying, I am very merciful, but don't take advantage of it. Because the thing with the mercy is that we actually make plenty of mistakes when we don't even intend to. When we get ourselves in enough trouble when we don't even mean to. So we really need, His mercy could overcome our intentional mistakes, but our attitude should be that I make enough mistakes on my own, I don't need to add to my headaches on that day. So I don't need to do anything intentionally wrong. And of course, we're gonna slip, but that's why we keep coming back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But He is reminding us that there is the day of justice. This is the day of justice. And this again, I think I mentioned it last week, it solves a very philosophical question. Why do bad things happen to good people? Because this world in your equation of justice, it should be dunya and akhirah. This world and the hereafter. If you just say all justice should occur in this world, then you're forgetting about the hereafter. And there's certain types of justice you can never attain in this world. A mass murderer who killed, you know, thousands of people and he never repented. Even if you catch that person and you hang him or you kill him, he only had one life to give. He took thousands of lives. That's not, at the end, justice. But it's the most you can get in this life. The hereafter is where you can get it. You know, the hereafter is where you can get it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can punish him, or He can give something, a compensation to the victims. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you something to make you forget about that. You know, so I know it's a very difficult question, and it's why people have trouble accepting religion. They're like, if there's a God, why do bad things happen? And we say, if you see all this, you see the wonders of the creation and how beautifully it was created, you know it wasn't created randomly. You know there's a being behind it. And if that being created something so magnificent as this entire universe, it doesn't make sense for Him to allow bad things to happen without an answer. There must be a reason. And that reason is that this world is a test. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put us here to see who is going to be the best in action and who is not. And once we understand, once a soul understands that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the master of the worlds, the master of creation, and He is extremely merciful, and He is the master of the day of judgment and time, these are actually reasons to say Alhamdulillah. And they also are a case for the next three verses of Surah Al-Fatiha. And that's the beauty about the surah. It relates to each other very harmoniously. The beginning, you could argue the rest of Surah Al-Fatiha is a reason to say Alhamdulillah. Or you could say the first three verses are to talk about the last three verses. And so the next verse we're going to talk about is إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Let me just write this. Okay.
You see the word like the day of give and take.
Yeah.
Giving to Allah.
Yeah. The best translation I've seen is, I think they say recompense, but no one really uses this word that I know of. My teacher, Ustad Noman, he said he's not a big fan of translations. He says, you know, they serve the point, which is basically to summarize what the Quran is saying, but a lot of Quranic terms, you can't just find a one word translation. It usually ends up being a sentence. For example, even the translation I put on my notes is not what you traditionally find in books. Especially for إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, it's a lot more wordier than what you would find in a translation. Can anyone remember, I talked about the benefits in Arabic of using a noun versus a verb. Does anyone remember? Or does anyone want to take a guess even? Yes, noun is infinite. And a verb is?
Depends on the tense.
Yeah, so a verb is restricted by time. For example, John wrote, past tense. John writes, present tense. John will write, future. John is a writer. Then that means writing is something that's always with John. It's just something it's a part of his essence, you know? So in Arabic, and I don't know if in English it really has this benefit quite exactly, but you know, you can understand it. But in Arabic, it does, definitely. The first three verses in Surah Al-Fatiha, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin, are all what you would call, I think, nominal sentences, verbs that start, or sentences that start with a noun. They're all talking about Allah. So Allah uses a noun-based sentence because He is eternal. So if you're going to talk about Him, you should talk about Him in an eternal way. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about Himself, He's using nouns because He is eternal. But the last three verses are really relate to the servant. And it's talking about it's directed at us and our relationship with Allah. But it's talking about us specifically. Those are verbs. Why? Because we may not always do it. Even when we're alive, we may not always worship Allah, we may not always ask Him for guidance. And also, by our very nature, we're not infinite. We're finite. We die, we go away at some point in time. And then we come back. And that's something very beautiful. The Fatiha is divided like that. There's balance between it. There's balance between infiniteness and finiteness. So that's something to notice. So the surah shifts right here. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, from talking about Allah to the slave. And when we talk about إِيَّاكَ, and on your handouts, it's going to say, only you we worship. Basically, the way Arabic is generally structured, if you're doing a verb, the object of the verb comes after, generally. Like, you know, John hit Mike. Mike is the object of hit, right? He's receiving the hitting. Abdullah worships Allah. But in Arabic, you have an opportunity to put the object before the verb. What's the benefit? In English, we don't have anything like that I know of. You can't say, Mike, John hit. You can't say that. This doesn't make sense. Maybe little kids say that. Maybe you could say, Mike was hit by John, but it doesn't quite exactly work. Maybe that's the closest example I could give. But in Arabic, when you put the object, so you're saying, it's saying, you, we worship. You, we worship. Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say that? It's allowed in Arabic, and there's benefits. The first benefit, when you do that, it means exclusivity. It means only you we worship. That meaning comes embedded in that structure when you say that. And it also shows that there are others that are worshipped. Doesn't say that they should be worshipped, but it's acknowledging the fact that people do worship other things. But it's also restricting the fact that we won't worship those things. We will only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that also brings up our next point, which is, when I say the word worship, what comes to your mind? Anybody? Prayer. Seclusion?
Submission.
Okay. If you were to go on the street, for example, if you were to go outside 14th Street and you had a survey, you had a mic, and you were to ask someone, what do you mean by worship? And let's say they're coming from a predominantly Christian background, they're going to think like something that's going on in the church, right? Because that's the way worship is used in English. But in Arabic, ibadah is a much more comprehensive term. And Quranic terms, again, it's hard to translate them with one word. Really, it has the connotation of worship and slavery or submission embedded in that. And in fact, even in the linguistic, if you look at it from a linguistic point of view, the words slavery and worship come from the same root word in Arabic, which is ayn bal ba dal, abada ya'budu or abuda ya'budu. And so basically, we are saying here that we willingly enslave ourselves and worship you. And I know that, and as I mentioned last week, it's very hard to say that, especially living in the Western context that we do or in the modern context that we do. The word slavery has, you know, a lot of connotations. But again, we have established the fact that Allah is a master like no other. He takes care of his slaves. He watches over his slaves. He's merciful. He's not always just trying to punish his slaves. That is not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when we enslave ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the benefit of saying that instead of just worshiping, there are people, you know, maybe we've run into these people, unfortunately, you know, they pray, they might fast, they might go to Hajj, they might go to Mecca, you know, they might give charity, but they cheat in their business. They backbite people, they gossip. They're like the last people on earth you'd want to do business with, you know, you'd want to interact with. But they do all these, what we would call rituals, right? So with Islam, what we're saying is, it's not just those acts. It's also our entire life. The way we eat, we're going to do it according to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us. The way we sleep, the way we interact with people, the way we deal with people financially, you know, the way we socially deal with people. If we're in a position of power, we're going to hold ourselves to a higher standard. You know, we're not going to take bribes. You know, we're going to deal justly. That is what's happening when you're saying, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِيدُ. And this is, and the slavery part was the part that the Quraysh, at the time of Prophet Muhammad, they had the most problems with. They didn't necessarily mind if you didn't worship their idol or not. But it was the fact that the Quraysh had, that their society had a lot of corruption. They used to kill their daughters. They used to bury their daughters alive because that the fact that they weren't sons. They used to engage in financial transactions whose interest rate was like 1,000,000%. You could never get out of that loan, even if you tried to pay it off. And then what they would take as collateral or revenge was just awful. You know, take people's daughters, take people's family members. Also, in addition to that, a lot of people forget the fact that the Quraysh were the elite of the Arabian Peninsula. One of the reasons why is because all the idols of all of these tribes at that time were housed in the Kaaba. Who was in charge of the Kaaba? It was the Quraysh. So for them, idols are kind of like how casinos are for Las Vegas. Las Vegas is a desert. There's no reason to be there. But why do people go there? For gambling, right? And it makes Las Vegas a lot of money. The Quraysh made a lot of money. Mecca, you know, if you've been to Mecca, there's nothing there. You know, there's no source of water, there's no agriculture. What brought people there was the Kaaba. And then what later on ended up happening was these idols. And people, when they go to Mecca, what do? They buy idols. And when they're there, they shop. So it was an economic, a source of income for the Quraysh. Their livelihood kind of depended on it. And then they didn't want to give up their way of life. In that society, the strong really took advantage of the weak. And back then, trade was done through caravans. And it was very common, if you were in a caravan and you're out in the desert, you will get attacked by that tribe. They would jump you. They would take all the valuables that were with you. You couldn't do that with the Quraysh. Why? They had your idol in the Kaaba. So, oh, you want to rob me? Oh, which one is your idol? The brown one in the corner? See what happens to it. It might fall off the shelf if you touch us. You couldn't touch the Quraysh. So they, and so for you to tell them to give up their idols, and they depended on this so much, it was difficult for them. And they didn't want to change, they didn't want to free slaves, they didn't want to treat people equally. You know, that was against the powers that be at that time. So that concept was very difficult for them to understand. So when a Muslim says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, it's a claim. It's a claim. And many scholars, when they talk about this verse, they'll reference another verse that's in Surah Al-Saff that says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. O you who believe, why do you say that which you do not do? Because if you notice, it says only you we worship. It doesn't say only you we're going to try to worship, we'll do our best to worship. You're standing in front of Allah, your creator, your master, and you are telling him, it's only you I worship and I enslave myself to. You know, and he knows what's going on in your heart and if you're serious about it. And yes, there are other verses which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. He doesn't put on a soul more than it can bear. There are narrations from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that say, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ, you know, fear Allah as much as you can. But in Surah Al-Fatiha, we're going for the highest level. We're not beating around the bush. It's a claim, it's a promise. I'll only worship you, and I'll only enslave myself to you. Also, people can also enslave themselves to other things. For example, you can say, someone can say, basketball's my life. What does that mean? You know, basketball dictates his life. You know, every day, you know, he goes to the court. You know, his diet is based on what's going to be most beneficial for him, for his basketball conditioning. You know, everything in his life revolves around basketball. You know, some people, their life revolves around, you know, alcohol, gambling, you know, rap music, whatever. You know, there's all types of things that people really make their God. It's their desires. Because human beings, if we give in to our desires, then at the end, we're just nothing but a person who is enslaved to his desires. If you talk to someone who's addicted to alcohol, they're like, I know it's wrong, but I just can't help myself. And we're not knocking those people who are struggling and who are doing their best, but it's just to illustrate the fact that you can be enslaved and a worshiper of your own desires. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, have you seen the one who has taken his desires as his slaves? I mean, as his God. The one who has taken his desires as his God. Why is that important? Because it may not be something you bow to. It may not be something that, you know, you dedicate a place of worship to. But in your heart, that concept, that idea, whatever it is, that dictates your life. That dictates how you eat. That dictates your time schedule. That dictates your priorities in life. But as a Muslim, we're saying, no, it's going to be Allah. So when I deal with my family, my priority is, how am I going to deal with my family to please Allah? When my family gets on my nerves, am I going to be unjust to them, or am I going to remember that there's Allah and I have to be nice to them? When I'm at my job, and let's say you clock in your hourly employee, am I going to lie? Am I going to clock in and then go goof off because I need to make some extra cash so, you know, I can buy this new jacket, this new sweater, this new shoe that's coming out, or I need to buy a new car? You know, are you going to let your desires for worldly things dictate how you're going to be? Or are you going to let your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dictate your each and every move? That's basically when you're saying you enslave yourself to Allah. You are saying, my each and every move is for you, Allah. And so basically when you eat, that's worship. When you're dealing with people, that's worship. If your intention is right, every single thing in your life can be worship. And we see this example in the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he even says there's beautiful narrations that when a Muslim man puts wife in his food, this is a type of charity. This is something you're supposed to be doing anyways, right? You're supposed to be nice to your spouse. You're supposed to be loving to your spouse. You're supposed to feed your spouse. You know, you're supposed to take care of your spouse. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful in saying this is charity, but it's also re-emphasizing the fact your entire life belongs to Allah. And this is why there might be a difference when you're talking to someone. When you just say worship, it doesn't capture the meaning because it's not just what we would call the ritual aspects. It's every single thing. The next part of the verse is nasta'een. Nasta'een is very important because, number one, Iyyaka na'budu, is this something very easy or difficult? To only worship Allah and enslave yourself to Allah. It's difficult, right? That's not an easy task. So right after you say, I need to worship, I'm going to worship you, you're going to say, Nasta'een. I'm going to only ask you for help. Why? I can't worship you without your help. Right then and there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, you won't be able to worship me without my help. And this, the benefit of this, it's the balance between human effort and divine effort. That some people say, I won't be good unless Allah changes my heart. You know, you might come across people, you know, don't do this, don't do that, like, oh, just do dua for me, ask Allah to make me a good person. The other extreme is that you can say every single thing in my life, whether it's worldly or religiously, it's from my own doing. If I'm a good Muslim, it's because I'm just that good. No, it's from Allah. He helped you. He aided you. So it's a balance between that. And it also shows that, again, when people say that Islam has no concept of mercy, and that, you know, you guys have to fast and pray and stay away from all these things, and we have it easy. We just say that we believe and that Jesus is the Son of Christ and we're forgiven, and that's it. Islam is saying, no, it's balanced. You have to do your part, but in the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you get over the humps, and He will help you worship Him and enslave yourself to Him willingly. And some scholars have said that, okay, this asking for help only goes back to worshiping Him. The second group of scholars said, no, this part is open-ended. And it's saying that we worship you and we ask for your help for everything, whether it's worshiping you, whether it's, you know, passing my exam in school, whether it's getting a new job, whether it's getting married, you know, whether it's being a good person or a good spouse, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help for everything. And again, they really don't contradict. Just one kind of adds complementary meaning to this. Also, nasta'in, there are many words in Arabic for help. For example, there is nasara. Nasara, for example, can anyone think of a surah that has the word nasara in it? Or the word nasr? Nasr. It's in the 30th juz as well. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ. Good job. So, in that verse, it's talking about nasr means to remove oppression or to give someone like a great amount of aid or assistance. It's not like, you know, can you help me erase this chalkboard? No, it's like someone has been oppressed, someone is in deep trouble, and they need help. The word nasara means this. The word nasta'in comes from the root word aun, and this word, ayn waw noon, it means help. You're helping someone, or you're asking for help, but the person who needs help is making effort on his own. So an example is, you're walking by someone and they have a flat tire. And you see the person just chilling on their cell phone and they're talking to their friends and they're updating their Facebook. You know, I'm on 285, I have a flat tire. And then you walk by, you say, hey, do you need some help? And you're like, oh yeah, yeah, you know, the spare's in the back and all the tools are in the back to change the flat tire. Is that person really helping himself? No, right? You might be like, hey man, get off the phone and, you know, help me, you know, change your tire for you. But isti'ana, it means the person, you know, they went in the back, they have a spare tire and they have all the tools, but maybe the spare needs air. And you walk by them and you say, hey, I'm doing all that I can, but can you like pump some air? Do you have a tire pump in your car or something? Or do you have another spare I can use on my car? That is really isti'ana. Why is that important? Because it's saying that you have to be trying to help yourself when you're asking Allah to guide you. You have to be doing your part. You can't just be like, oh, Allah, guide me, and then go drink a 40-ounce or go to the club or do something wrong. You gotta be doing your part. You know, you have to be doing your effort. Also, isti'ana, Arabic has, they have verbs, and then you can put these verbs, you can give them add-ons, basically, right? So the original verb was ana ya'inu, But on this form, it becomes isti'ana. Just to be a little bit technical with you, but just to explain the benefit of this form, nasta'in. Nasta'in means to ask, but it also means that you really want the thing you're asking for. You know, for a best example is you're at work, and your boss tells you, you know, remind me to give you this assignment. And when you're done with the current assignment, you're done with that assignment, and then you go to your boss's office, and you're like, oh, hey, do you remember that thing you told me to do? You know, I'm ready to do it. Most of us, unless you really, really love your job, you don't want to ask, you don't want to remind your boss, you don't want to ask for that next assignment. But you have to anyways, right? But with nasta'in, it's not like that. You're asking for help to worship Allah, but you really, really want that help. And again, it's balance between what's in the heart and what's on the tongue. And this is something very, again, very profound, because we see the surah has balance. Surah Fatiha has balance between talking about Allah and His slave. Balance between finite and infinite. Balance between mercy and justice. Balance between hope and fear. Balance between human effort, divine effort. Balance between what's in the heart and what's on the tongue. And scholars have written like 3-volume books just on this one ayah, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ, because of all the lessons you can really connect it to. But what's really amazing about this is, many times when you pray to Allah, what are things that most people ask God for? Any examples?
A new car.
What else?
Health.
What else? Money? Okay. Are these things worldly things or things with regards to the hereafter? Dunya, right? And most people, when you think to ask of God, you don't think you can ask God to help you worship Him. For example, you might find it boring, salah boring. You might find praying boring. You might find it boring to read the Quran. Well, Allah already knows you find it boring, right? You can actually ask Him, say, Ya Allah, I'm struggling. I don't find it interesting. I know I don't understand what's there. Clear my heart. Help me find it interesting. Ya Allah, I have trouble concentrating in prayer. Ya Allah, I lie. I don't know why I lie. I can't help but to backbite. I'm addicted to alcohol. I'm trying to get over it. I know it's wrong. You can tell Him those things. He already knows. And it's not like a human being. You might tell your parent and they're like, what are you doing? And they might, you know, hit you or yell at you or ground you. You come to Allah honestly, and you be open and you're honest with Allah, and He will be generous and honorable and merciful to you. And that's what this is saying. And you can come to Him for anything. You know when like a teacher or your parents says, my door is always open? That's what Allah is saying. His door is eternally open. His door will be open even after we're long gone and dead. It'll be open for our children and our grandchildren and people afterwards. And this door was always open before us. And this is really the beauty of Islam, and the beauty of Surah Al-Fatiha is that the surah that we read so often, we have to read this so many times in a day. Why? Because it contains all a great summary of this religion. When you wake up in a day is a collection of choices. A day is a collection of choices. Every day you're given a set of choices. Are you going to do the right thing or the wrong thing? And when you start off your day at Fajr prayer early in the morning, you're reminding yourself how wonderful Allah is. You know, and you're reminding yourself of how merciful He is. And then you're reminding yourself you have to stand in front of Him and He has full control, and it's going to be on a day even the people that don't worship Him are going to have to acknowledge Him. And they might be humiliated on that day. And this is a tall task and I need His help. And you're constantly reminding yourself. And also, salah is not just I don't want to say spiritual experience, but it's not just experience of the heart. It's also an experience of the mind. And what's also beautiful is that slavery is a state of the heart and the mind. You know, even in history, when they freed certain slaves, they still stuck around their master, right? Why? Because in their mind, they were still a slave. They didn't know how to function. Us as Muslims, we're the same way. We can't function without Allah. It's a state of the mind and the heart. And nasta'in is also, it's a state of more or less the heart. And we're in a state of desperation. And so when you're in salah, it should be an intellectual and spiritual experience. You know, you should be, your heart should be clean. You know, you should feel that love for Allah. And you should be thinking about how you're going to live your life for Allah. How are you going to live the rest of your life and the rest of that day for Allah? And you might reflect upon your day and say, you know, I didn't do this, you know, and I'm contradicting the fact that I said, Iyyaka na'budu wa Iyyaka nasta'in. This is why when the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet Muhammad, when they prayed Salah, they enjoyed it. They understood it. Because Salah for them was an intellectual and spiritual experience. And we have to try to make it that way. I definitely went over my time. Inshallah, next week we'll finish off Surah Al-Fatiha. We'll cover the last two verses. Anything I said that was good is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anything that I said that was incorrect is from the evil of my own soul. And I hope I educated you guys and confused you a little bit less. If there's any questions, the floor is open.